This is Friday, September 26, 2014. We are in Natick, Massachusetts, and this tape is part of the Morse Institute Library's continuing Veterans Oral History Project. My name is Maureen Sullivan. Our cameraman is Dan McDermott of Natick Pegasus. We are privileged to have with us today Philip Cahill. Welcome, Phil.
Thank you.
May I ask when you were born?
1923.
And what month and day?
July 20, 1923.
Where were you born?
In Boston.
And what community do you currently live in?
I live in Natick now.
Your marital status?
I'm widowed.
Do you have children?
Yes, I have two children, a boy and a girl. They are both in their 60s at this point, so I don't know as I would correctly call them a boy and a girl.
Do you have grandchildren?
I have two granddaughters, each of whom has, my older granddaughter has three children, and my younger one has two.
Now, tell us what the Boston area was like when you were growing up.
Well, it hasn't changed that much except for modern inventions. Mm-hmm. We took the trolley cars on Commonwealth Avenue to go to Kenmore Square and the doctor and dentist.
What did your parents do for a living?
My father was an ear, nose, and throat surgeon, and my mother had been a nurse.
Did you have brothers or sisters?
I have a brother who was a year and a half younger.
What school did you go to?
I went to St. Aidan's Grammar School, which was on Pleasant Street in Brookline.
And after that?
I went to Boston College High School. And then I had 3 years at Holy Cross College in Worcester.
While you were attending BC High, were you made aware of events happening in Europe and Asia at that time?
Yes, we. That was the more or less the height of the Depression. I started high school in 1936, and I graduated in 1940.
And from there you went to College of the Holy Cross in Worcester.
I'm sorry?
You went to Holy Cross.
Yeah, I went there for 3 years.
And what was your major?
I majored in English and sociology.
What were you planning to do after, if you had graduated?
I have no idea. I didn't think about it. I did not think that I would go into the medical profession, but my younger brother did.
Do you remember what you were doing On December 7th, 1941.
Yes. My grandmother, my father's mother, mm-hmm. who was about in her late 80s, lived in Worcester. When he attended Holy Cross College, he was a day student. And he got in shape for the track season by running from where he lived to Mount St. James, which is where Holy Cross is located.
Now, what were you doing on December 7th?
I was visiting my grandmother. Okay. And I walked over there. She lived near Elm Park, which was a big public landscape park in Worcester. And I was visiting her, and I came back to my room at college and heard about the attack all on Pearl Harbor.
Were you aware at the time what Pearl Harbor was?
No.
But in the days that followed, you kind of found out, didn't you?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Now, did you try to enlist immediately, or were you still too young?
Did I what?
Did you try to join the military, or were you still too young?
No, we were advised not to leave school, and I joined the reserve, Air Force Reserve, in the fall of 1942.
What made you choose the Air Force?
I wasn't interested in the Navy, and I suppose I thought it would be more exciting.
Were you called into service? Were you drafted? Or
no,
did you just?
I enlisted mm-hmm. in the reserve, Air Force Reserve, in the fall of 1942, and I was called to active service in January of 1943.
What were you doing while you were in the Air Force Reserves?
I was bombardier in the 15th Air Force.
But while you were still in college with the reserves?
Well, the reserve, I was not in the active mm-hmm. Reserve. I didn't go to drill. We had ROTC, naval ROTC, at Holy Cross, but I was not in the Naval ROTC, and was called to active duty in the winter of 43.
Where were you sent first?
I was sent to Atlantic City for basic training.
Tell us what that was like.
Well, the Air Force had apparently taken over the most of the hotels in Atlantic City, which was well supplied with hotels. And after we went to a reception in the area, I was sent with a friend of mine who was in the reserve at Dartmouth College, and we were called up on the same day. We went to the Senator Hotel, which was kind of a not too interesting. It was not one of the palatial hotels at Atlantic City.
What else do you remember about basic?
Well, I contracted a heavy and disabling cold, and I was put in the hospital at Atlantic City, and I was in the hospital virtually till the time I was reassigned to an aviation student training program at the George Peabody Teachers College, which was in Nashville, Tennessee.
Now, Phil, at the time, was this the first time you were away from Massachusetts during basic and when you went to Nashville?
Yes. Mm-hmm. Except, I was in Massachusetts when I was in college. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. So now you're in Nashville. Tell us what aviation school was like.
Well, aviation student training, the Air Force took over a number of institutions of higher learning, and the George Peabody Teachers College, which was located in Nashville, was one of the institutions of higher learning. We had a drill once a day and took various fringe military courses at Peabody Teachers College.
Now, did you decide to become a bombardier, or did the Air Corps choose you?
The Air Force, mm-hmm. It was no longer the Air Corps. When I was called to active duty there, they tried everyone for pilot training because they knew, obviously, if they lost a plane, they were likely to lose the pilot. And so they wanted to train as many people as they could. But I must confess that the instructor pilot who taught me was a little incredulous that I had managed to obtain a driver's license in Massachusetts. But I went to pilot training initially, but if they didn't think you showed sufficient aptitude to be a pilot, then they sent you to something else based on, in part, at least on your responses to multiple choice tests.
Okay, so were you sent elsewhere for bombardier training, or did you remain in Nashville?
No, I did not. I went. It happened that the Nashville happened to be the location of the classification center for the eastern part of the Air Force, and after I went to the preliminary training, I was sent to the Nashville Classification Center to determine where I would be sent for further instruction, and I was sent ultimately to Ocala, Florida, which was the site of a airport, and most of the personnel were either diverted service pilots, or they chose to go into the service rather than they taught. We were instructed on Piper Cubs and planes of that sort.
Phil, do you remember around what time that was when you were in Florida?
Yes, it was the winter.
Of what year?
Hmm?
What year?
Late 43.
So at this time, you were about 20 years old?
Yes.
And were you being instructed in the use of a Piper Cub?
We were being sent up for instruction in Piper Cubs and various small aircraft with professional, semi-professional instructors who were more concerned, I think, with saving their lives and keeping the pupils from crashing the planes. I don't blame them.
Self-preservation's a wonderful thing. But you didn't crash the plane.
No, I didn't. I landed several, but my confidence ratio evidently did not impress the instructor that I went up with.
So you got another instructor who didn't think
you could do it. I think that they were more concerned with saving their own lives. Mm-hmm. And they gave you check rides, and that was when the instructor that I had asked me if I had had any problems getting a driver's license in Massachusetts. And from there I was sent to Moody Field, which was in Valdosta, Georgia. And we did not fly at Moody Field. We took basic training, textbook type, and we were pretty much on our own.
How was that being on your own?
Well, we had a roll call in the morning, and to some extent we were pretty much our own bosses for the rest of the day. We did not have any, that I recall, any instruction.
During the time you were in Georgia, did you ever go off base and visit the town?
Yes. I went into Valdosta to the USO. And I played a little golf at a semi-public course in Valdosta.
And where exactly was that?
What?
The town in Georgia. Was it near Augusta or Columbia?
I have no idea. We took the train from Ocala, Florida, to Valdosta, Georgia, and had never been in the southern states before. So where we went was news to me.
Mm-hmm. When you were in the community off base, were you treated all right?
Yes.
Okay. And what was your rank at the time?
I was an aviation student.
And how long were you stationed in Georgia?
A couple of months, I would.
So we're still pretty much in 1943 still?
I'm sorry?
Are we still in 1943?
Yes.
Okay. Tell us what happened after Georgia.
Well, if you were assigned to some other positional training, I went to Bombardier School, and before I went there, I was sent to Aerial Gunnery School because the Bombardier, though mainly a passenger until you got to the vicinity of the target, was a passenger.
Where was Aerial Gunnery School?
In Panama City, Florida.
And what did Aerial Gunnery School involve?
A lot of textbook training and aircraft recognition so you wouldn't shoot down any of the... You had a gun that you were assigned to training with, and we trained on mobile targets which were towing sleeves.
Anything else you remember about the training in that school?
No, that we had aircraft recognition, so yep. You wouldn't shoot down your own planes, and we had some basic textbook stuff, and we eventually we did a lot of classroom stuff.
And how long were you stationed down at Panama City?
I went there in the fall of 1943, and I was sent to Bombardier Training School in early 1944.
And where was Bombardier School?
In San Angelo, Texas.
Still down south, huh?
Yes. Well, the weather was a principal factor on that.
And what took place in Bombardier School?
What? A lot of textbook things, and we were trained to in the theory of the Norden bomb sight, which was very reasonably accurate. and we were trained in aircraft recognition because we were still a part of the gunnery crew on a, we would be part of the gunnery crew in a heavy bombardment group. And at San Angelo, we did a certain amount of training on bomb sites, which were controlled by the student. And they were, there were mobile targets. And we were assigned to familiarize ourselves with this. This was 50 or 60 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
So, and eventually I graduated from Bombardier School, and in a class that graduated, I believe, in April 1944.
Now, while you were in Bombardier School, were you trained, you were trained in bomb sites and other equipment, were you told that you're going to be eventually assigned to, say, a B-17 or a B-24?
No, you...
Okay.
I was eventually assigned to a B-24 unit, mm-hmm. Which was flying out of Italy.
Now, during the time you were training, how did you best hear about what was happening in Europe?
Well, we had the newspapers and the radio. It was well before television became popular.
Did you get letters from home?
Yes. I was in San Angelo, was in West Texas, mm-hmm. and we did most of our practicing in Texas and Oklahoma.
You mentioned your brother early in the interview. Was he a veteran of World War II as well?
Yes, he was. He was younger than I, and he was a year behind me at high school and at Holy Cross College. And he was relatively young for the situation that he found himself in. He graduated from Tufts Medical School in at the age of 25 or 6.
But did he serve during the war?
Yes. And he was released from the service, but because of his age, his young age, he was had to go in the reserve, and he would have been drafted. He was more familiar with this procedure than I was. Mm-hmm. Eventually went to Japan during the Korean conflict, and he was there for a year or possibly a small amount more. And I was not in Japan, so.
Well, let's get you back to you just graduated from Bombardier School.
Yes.
Was it still 43, or are we now in 1944?
I'm sorry?
Bombardier School, you graduated in what year?
I was assigned, sent to Westover Field, which was near Springfield, Massachusetts.
And when was that?
In 1944.
And were you still a student, or had you been commissioned?
I had been commissioned as a second lieutenant.
And what unit were you a part of?
I didn't have any specific assignment, and I was sent from Westover Field to Charleston, South Carolina, where this was called a replacement training center for personnel replacement for crews which had been lost one way or another.
Of course, now you're talking about the summer of 1944. You have the invasion of Normandy, the invasion of Italy. And now you're in Charleston, South Carolina at a replacement center. Tell us what happened next.
Well, we were given a short leave, a week or a little more, and we were sent from Westover to a replacement training center in Charleston, South Carolina, and practiced various types of missions, and we were had to become qualified as to repair or replace components of air-to-air machine guns. Mm-hmm.
And how long did this take?
I was... I went to Westover Field in late April of 1944 and was there for 4 or 5 months, and then we received a week's leave and came back to Charleston and were assigned to temporary duty at Mitchell Field, which was outside New York City on Long Island. I think that Lindbergh may have taken off from Mitchell Field when he crossed the Atlantic. But we were assigned a new B-24. In the meantime, we had made up a crew of pilot, co-pilot, navigator, and bombardier, and radio operator, and chief engineer, and two or three who were machine gunners.
Okay, Phil, you're in New York on temporary duty. The crew is together. Tell us what happened next.
Well, we went to Mitchell Field and picked up a brand new B-24, which had not been camouflaged. It was one of the Silver Fleet. And we flew that up to Dow Field in Bangor, outside Bangor, Maine, and then St. John's in Canada, and Gander Lake, which was a field in Newfoundland, and we flew from Gander Lake to the Azores. Our crew, which was complete at this point, we flew to the Azores, and we flew from the Azores to Marrakech, which was in Morocco, and we flew from Marrakech to Tunis, which was, I think, partly near Morocco in northern Africa. And eventually from there, we flew to a replacement base in Italy, at which point the powers that be took away the new plane that we had been assigned to and gave us an old assignment to take an older one over to a base in Italy. And I was, our crew were assigned to the 456th Heavy Bomb Group and the 746th Squadron, which was located in a small town in southern Italy called Stornara, S-T-O-R-N-A-N-A.
Tell us what that was like.
Well, it was, we arrived there just about the time that it was just after the invasion of Normandy. And we arrived there just about the time that the strategists had decided to invade southern France, and we had our first bombing missions in southern France in Marseille and Toulon. And then eventually the Allies broke out of the Normandy and France, and we went to more or less permanent assignments where our group, the 456th Heavy Bomb Group, was located, which was in Stornara. And we flew missions to various targets, mostly associated with refining or storage of fuel, petroleum. And we flew to Bulgaria and various places like that. And eventually we were sent to the last mission that I went on, to a town which was a major storage area for petroleum called Black Hammer, B-L-E-C-H-H-A-M-M-E-R. That had been part of Poland before the Germans took it over. It was probably in the Sudetenland. And that was the last mission that I went on. Our plane was crippled and we had to bail out, and we lost about half the crew. And the German occupants of the towns of Tropau, T-R-O-P-P-A-U, and Gliwice, G-L-E-I-W-I-T-Z. That's where we were, what remained of our crew were imprisoned until we were sent back through Germany to prison facilities near the Rhine.
Okay, Phil, let's go back just a little bit. When was your plane crippled?
Near the end of July, August, I'm sorry, in 1944.
And was your plane shot down by any aircraft?
Yes, anti-aircraft.
And how many missions did you undertake before you were shot down?
When I was on six or seven.
And when you were captured, did your captors treat you all right, or were you interrogated?
When I landed on the ground, I was my parachute was entangled in the top of a fairly high pine tree, and I had to get down from there, and I was reconnoitering the surroundings, and I was informed that I was a captive of they never identified themselves, but they were youthful local, more or less, Boy Scouts, and they had a couple of Gauleiters who took charge of me, and they were obviously, in reflecting on it, I come to the conclusion that they didn't want to be designated as mistreating prisoners, and they left me to a couple of Gauleiters who drove me around to where some members of my crew were dead. And they obviously, to me at least, they were interested in saying that they had nothing to do with their chute didn't open, or angry villagers had pummeled them to death, and that was the sort of thing. We had a crew of 10, and half of them did not survive the plane crash.
At any time when you were in local custody, did they take any equipment away from you, like a jacket or your boots?
Like what?
Did they take your jacket, your boots?
No, nobody. They, when we, I was in an area which had been part of Poland, and I was nobody, they took my wallet and my things like that. I don't remember being forcibly deprived of any essential items of clothing or...
Okay. Were you reunited with the rest of your crew?
Yes, those who survived. We all wound up in the local jail in Tropau.
Were you treated all right?
Yes.
Were you or any of the crew injured?
The chief pilot of our plane, William Smith, who came from the Providence, Rhode Island area, had been shot in the foot as he was bailing out of the plane, since it had insufficient power to stay on track to get back to Italy.
Did he receive medical treatment?
Yes, I assume he did. I didn't see him again, but he received some medical treatment.
Tell us what happened at your inner local jail in Tropau. What happened next?
Well, we got some pretty lurid tales about how the Germans were bombing New York City and things of that nature. But they German soldiers who were acting as our jailers were more interested in not being sent to the Russian front than anything else. And eventually, after two or three days, we were assigned guards who took us on the train from the Tropau-Gleiwitz area eastward, westward through Germany to Frankfurt. And that we were in more or less solitary confinement. We were fed, and eventually we were interrogated by what, to my recollection, were fairly skilled interrogators. And they accompanied us. We had one guard for every, our pilot, William Smith, did not go with us because he was receiving medical treatment. And I went with the chief engineer, the radio operator, and a couple of the gunners from the plane who parachuted safely down and were imprisoned. And we, Frankfurt was a sort of a reception center, and that's where I wound up. And the they gave us clothing, and after a week or 10 days, we were taken to a railroad station and brought to Stalag Luft 3, which is well described in this book.
You want to just hold that book for a moment? Just want to hold that up for a moment for the camera. And where exactly was Stalag Luft 3?
Stalag Luft 3 was about 40 miles in a southerly direction from Berlin. And I had never been to Germany before, so I didn't have any familiarity with the location.
When you were sent to Luft Stalag Luft 3. You were sent to the Stalag, I would say, around late 1944, around the fall?
Yes. We arrived at Stalag Luft 3 on Labor Day of 1944. And the prisoners, unbeknownst to us, were accustomed to celebrate any holidays, which they did, and they were having athletic events.
Now, this particular Stalag, was it just American prisoners of war or Allied?
Well, it's a little difficult to say. The camp that I was in, the center camp of Stalag Luft 3 was probably three-quarters at least of American POWs. It had started out as a air Luftwaffe camp for prisoners, and my daughter got, I happened to see something about this, and my daughter, not the one who, my granddaughter obtained it through Amazon.
Now, were you assigned to a barracks?
Yes, I was, when we arrived, we marched into, I don't mean a drill, we marched into a receiving area of Stalag Luft 3, and one of the POWs who had been there for over a year had a sort of a responsible position in the hierarchy of the POWs, and he was accustomed to looking at it, looking over the list of prisoners of war who were put into the camp, and he saw that I came from Brookline and he came from Newton. So they were getting a little overcrowded, and he said they had to take two new POWs in their room, which had 10 people and they had to take 12. So I had a friend whose acquaintance I had made. He came from Texas, and he said he'd be happy to join the assigned group, and we went to one of the barracks, which probably held close to 100. And I stayed there with my friend whose name was, he said, J-Z-R-O-W-E. And he remained a roommate as long as we were in that camp, and actually we got moved from that camp to another one not far from Munich.
What would be a typical day in your life as a POW?
Well, we would clean up the room. We had approximately 12. I came from Brookline. Robert Gluck, who was Jewish and was fluent in Yiddish, was a translator, because Yiddish, he was a German Jew, and he was more or less of a confidant of the guards. And he ultimately moved to Florida and died there 6 or 7 years ago. Mm-hmm. My son was living in Miami at that time, and he looked up Mrs. Gluck and found her, so I talked to her on the telephone about her husband Bob. I played a very great deal of bridge with him. We didn't have much to do.
What about the food at the Stalag?
Well, they had mass production cooking facilities, and potatoes and cabbage were very popular. And we could get hot water at the main cookhouse, and that was pretty much staffed by former. I shouldn't say former, they were still prisoners who had been early occupants of Stalag Luft 3. Well, at one time, it was the central camp, and eventually it radiated out to all points of the compass.
Did you ever receive Red Cross packages?
Yes, we received approximately half of a parcel per week. It had instant coffee and margarine and various crackers and various types of, had a certain number of cigarettes. My fellow roommate, Dexter LaShawn, whose father had invented the trailer in which you have seen a lot of great many new cars being transported. And Dexter LaShawn, Lester was his father's name, and he had made a great success of this. And I have not seen him for at least 35 or 40 years. I never met his father, but he lived next door to a well-known columnist for the Boston Herald and traveler, Bill Cunningham. And Mr. Cunningham wrote a paperback about Dexter LaShawn titled The Kid Next Door. And I roomed with Dexter for at least a year.
Did the Germans ever try to take parcels or supplies from you?
Not that I know of. They tried to prevent our preserving them so that they could provide food for escapes.
Were there any escape attempts at the Stalag?
Yes. Near the time when I got out of Stalag, when the Russians advanced fairly close to Stalag Luft 3, and eventually in the winter of 45, they moved us out of there, and we trudged around the landscape for from one farmhouse to another for a week or 10 days. And they didn't want, we were fortunate that the Russians did not acquire custody of that, of our people. And I think that due to Field Marshal Gehring's close relationship to Adolf Hitler, I'm not aware that there was any mistreatment of the, if you, in this book, there is something about a group of the long-term POWs who invited and took charge of financing a trip of some of our supervisory people of the former captives, and there was some criticism of the fact that they were not more riled up about their treatment, but I don't recall anything of that type.
You mentioned the winter of 45, so you were a prisoner of war during a fairly cold winter. Did you have adequate clothing and heat?
Well, nobody froze to death. And we didn't, fortunately, Dexter LeShawn had the Germans under the Geneva Convention, they were required to pay us monthly the same as a German officer of the same rank would receive. And fortunately, Dexter LeShawn was sort of the commissary person, and he had authority given by the senior Allied officers. Colonel Spivey was the senior, most senior, S-P-I-V-E-Y. He subsequently, after he got back to the States, he was the head of Culver Academy, which was a military boarding school. And I think that, as far as I am concerned, he did a good job. I corresponded with him back. There was an article about him in Time magazine back in the 80s, and I don't think I have a copy of it. Mm-hmm. His name was Delmar, D-E-L-M-A-R, T, I don't know what that stood for, Spivey, S-P-I-V-E-Y.
Now, Phil, you mentioned being taken out of Stalag Luft 3 and going from farmhouse to farmhouse. What happened afterward?
Well, we wound up in Stalag 7A, which we came to a railhead, and they marched us off the cattle cars that we had been in, and transported us to Stalag 7A, which was a different POW camp. And that's the only place where I recall there was, we could have used more heat.
And how long were you in Stalag 7A?
We arrived there early in January of 45, and the war in Europe ended in the late spring of 45, and we were moved in DC-3s, which were personnel transport planes. We were moved from there to Camp Lucky Strike, which was in the vicinity of Le Havre, which was a seaport. And they fattened us up and took care of medical problems, and it eventually we were put on a transport ship, the USS General Gordon. I don't know whether that was General Gordon of Khartoum, but I have no idea. But we took a more or less southern route, and by the time we got back to this side of the Atlantic Ocean, it was summertime.
Okay, let's go back for just a second. Where exactly was Stalag 7A?
Stalag 7A was in the vicinity of Munich.
Munich, okay.
In Bavaria.
And who liberated you?
General Patton's group.
And what was that like when you found out the camp had been liberated?
Well, my group managed to liberate the German equivalent of a Jeep, and we decided some of the people who were in our group wanted to see Paris. So we let them go, and we rode up to the ferry to Nuremberg, and we drove back to Stalag 7A, and that's where we were transported to Camp Lucky Strike. I don't know if all of the similar places were named after cigarettes, mm-hmm. but...
I remember some like Chesterfield, yeah.
Yeah.
All right, so now you're back in the, on American soil, the summer of 45.
Yes.
Were you discharged?
No, we were received approximately 2 months of rehabilitation leave and were, I was married by this time, and when I had to return to active service, I returned, strangely enough, to Atlantic City. I was in a more swish hotel than I had mm-hmm. been in the Senator. Eventually, after a couple of weeks there, we were assigned to be released from active service, and we were encouraged to sign up for the reserves, and we were sent because one of my friends who lived in Newton had a friend who was a billeting officer in Atlantic City. We got to pick where we wanted to go, and we decided to go to Harrisburg, Pennsylvania. And we had a friend, one of the people with whom I, my wife and I rode to Atlantic City. Had acquired a secondhand Plymouth while he was enjoying his rehabilitation leave, and we drove to Harrisburg and stayed there for a couple of or 3 days, and then drove back to the Brookline, Newton area.
All right, so now you signed up for the reserves.
Yes.
And what rank were you when the war ended?
I was still a second lieutenant, which I had been commissioned as in April of 1944.
Mm-hmm. How long did you stay in the reserves?
I left the reserves in probably I was still in the reserves, to the best of my recollection, in 1950, when I had been to law school mm-hmm. and was practicing law with a small firm in Boston, and I had graduated law school, and I resigned from the reserves, and they speedily told me they had been waiting for my complaints about not having been promoted for 5 years from second lieutenant to first lieutenant, and they sent me papers, but I didn't have to sign up for additional reserve service, so I did not.
Where did you go to law school?
Boston College.
You didn't know Joe Sullivan, did you?
I don't remember. I knew several Sullivans. Dick Sullivan was our professor of labor law, and he was exceptionally good.
I asked that because Joe Sullivan was my father, and he went to BC Law School the same time you did.
Oh. Well, we were at 18 Tremont Street. If he went to law school when the law school, when I started in it, was at 441 Stewart Street, and over the Christmas vacation, they transferred the entire law school library and records to 18 Tremont Street, which was known as the Kimball Building, and it was right next door to King's Chapel Burying Ground.
Ah, all right, Phil. Did you join any veterans organizations?
No, not that I recall. My mother was a member of the American Legion. First World War.
No kidding. And did you use the GI Bill to go to law school?
Yes.
Okay. Right, Phil, how important was it for you to serve in the military?
To what?
How important was it for you to serve in the military?
To?
Serve.
Grow up?
No, no, to serve in the military.
Oh. Well, I never sought it out for, but I certainly, when I was at Holy Cross College in Worcester, the draft was going on. And I was, Pearl Harbor had taken place, and I would be drafted if I didn't sign up for some sort of reserve duty, and as a result, I signed up with the Air Force.
Is there anything, any other stories, anything else you'd like to say before we wrap this up?
Well, no, it was, I was interested in the fact that because I had a second-hand connection with Dexter LaShawn, that and he was always interested in anyone who came from Newton or an adjoining town such as Brookline, that he took me over to the space he had been given to carry on his commissary type of activities. And I saw that the Germans had he had purchased anything that he could buy, he would buy with the credits which he had for our salaries as German officer equivalents. And he bought a lot of shaving sticks. And I commented to him that I understood that the Germans were very busy at converting things out of petroleum, and we should take a few samples of the shaving sticks and see if they had been possibly were highly flammable, and they were, which we had, we were very fortunate that we had a constant demand on us to supply shaving sticks. We had pot-type stoves in our rooms. Mm-hmm. And ours was probably a little warmer than average.
Phil, is there anything else?
No.
Okay. Well, Philip Cahill, we thank you so very much for sharing your experiences for the Natick Veterans Oral History Project.
Thank you.
Thank you.